Today I would like to show you how we can produce conventional liquid hydrocarbon fuels such as gasoline and kerosene from these three ingredients: water, CO2, and solar energy. Why is that important? 3 days ago, I took the flight Zurich-San Francisco. I flew over 5,800 miles with an Airbus 340, which carries 300 passengers and 50,000 gallons of kerosene, of jet fuel. So a back-of-the-envelope calculation is telling me that my carbon footprint on that particular day was 1.4 tons of CO2. Now, considering that worldwide there are 50,000 flights a day carrying 3 million passengers, it's not a surprise that global aviation is responsible for 900 million tons CO2 per year. Now, if we consider all transportation, including cars, then we are talking 3.9 billion tons of CO2 per year. This represents 14% of the anthropogenic CO2 emissions. Now, but today I don't want to talk about general CO2 emissions. I want to focus on those CO2 emissions derived from liquid fuels for transportation, and specifically for aviation. And this is because there are no alternative fuels for aviation. There is no way around jet fuel. We are not going to fly Boeings with batteries. So the solve4x becomes, how can we eliminate the carbon footprint derived from the use of liquid hydrocarbon fuels without the need for abstaining from flying or driving? Now, I'm going to keep the warm up, and I'm going to attach the annual solar irradiation. This is in units of kilowatts per square meter. And I'm going to do the following back of the envelope calculation. The energy consumption by global transportation, all means of transportation, is this number that you see here, 2.8 times 10 to the 13 kilowatt hour per year. Now, let's assume you pick up a region where the annual irradiation is at least 2,000 kilowatt hour per square meter, so anywhere in this dark orange region. And further, let's assume that we have a technology within a conversion efficiency of 20%. Now, the solar area required for covering the complete energy consumption by transportation becomes a square of 160 times 160 miles, which is drawn in scale here in the state of Arizona. Now, what you see here is a photograph of a commercial solar power plant, CSP, based on steam Rankine cycle. This one is in the south of Spain. There are many of these solar towers being built around the world, several of them here in California. Now, we are going to be making use of the same solar concentrating infrastructure. We will use the same heliostat field, concentrated solar radiation on top of the tower. We will remove the boiler from the top of the tower, and we will place a solar reactor, which we are feeding with water and CO2, and producing these solar fuels. Now, let's make a close-up on the process here inside the solar reactor. We are talking about what is called a solar thermochemical redox cycle. Redox is for reduction oxidation. Two steps. In the first solar reduction step, the metal oxide is thermally reduced, oxygen is set free. In the second step, second oxidation step, the reduced metal oxide reacts with water to generate hydrogen, with CO2 to CO, and the original oxidized metal oxide, which is recycled to the first step. So the net reaction is solar energy in, water and CO2 in, oxygen out, and hydrogen and CO out. This mixture is called Syngas. It's a key mixture, the precursor for the synthesis of liquid hydrocarbon fuels. What you see here is the solar reactor technology. Consists of a cavity with a small opening to let in concentrated solar energy. This cavity contains the reacting material. It's ceria, which is in the form of RPC. This is short for reticulated porous ceramic, a foam type structure. And this is the way this solar reactor operates. Remember, two steps. During the first solar reduction step, we introduce concentrated solar energy, enters the cavity, undergoes multiple internal reflections, it's absorbed. This is the way that we deliver the high temperature process heat at around 1500 degrees Celsius. The ceria undergoes reduction, oxygen evolves and exits through this outlet port here at the rear part of the reactor. Once the first step is completed, we are ready to move into the second step. By the way, the second step is slightly exothermic. We don't need any a source of energy. So we stop the input of solar energy. Here is the the oxidation. And we bring the reactor to 900 degrees Celsius. This is for kinetic reasons. We introduce the reacting gases, water and CO2, radially, which flow across the porous RPC, react to generate hydrogen and CO, which exits through the same outlet port, producing syngas. Syngas is processed to liquid hydrocarbon fuels. Now, we have built a 4 kilowatt prototype solar reactor. Just to give you an idea of the dimensions, here the aperture is 5 centimeters in diameter. And in this reactor, we have measured experimentally a solar to fuel efficiency of 2%. Let me explain what is this efficiency. The definition is the solar to fuel energy conversion efficiency, the heating value of the fuel produced, divided by the solar energy input. This is the most important performance indicator of the reactor technology of the process, very directly linked to the economics. Now, our analysis indicates we should be able to reach efficiencies of around 20%. And when we do that, then a solar tower similar to the one that you see here in this photograph, and here you see the area that occupies, this solar tower should be able to produce 4,100 gallons a day of gasoline or kerosene. One issue still needs to be solved. What is going to be the source of CO2? For a true sustainable process, CO2 should be captured from atmospheric air. We have developed an absorption-desorption process based on temperature vacuum swing cycle using amine functionalized cellulose. In this way, we can capture pure CO2. While we are doing that, we are also recapturing water from the humidity in the air. And this is also for dry air, because even dry air has 10 times more water content than CO2. To summarize, we have an absorption-desorption process to capture CO2 and water from atmospheric air. These are the two ingredients that we need for the redox thermochemical cycle using concentrated solar radiation to produce the syngas mixture, which is further processed using conventional catalytic processes to the liquid fuel hydrocarbons, gasoline, kerosene, diesel, and these liquid fuels that we use for transportation. Now the material cycle is perfectly closed. This is a true sustainable process. And I'm coming back to the first slide, and I'm going to make a slight change in the title, gasoline and kerosene from there you go. Thank you.